Okay, class, welcome to Algebra 1. What we're going to look at today is the real number system. We're going to start with this and talk about all the different types of numbers that you may find. We're going to start off with our natural numbers. Our natural numbers, you just start counting off 1, 2, 3, etc. These are the numbers you started off when you were really little in kindergarten and you had to first start counting. So these are what you're called your natural numbers. On the next level up, we go to whole numbers. Really, the only number that we add to is 0. When you include 0 with the natural number set, then we have your whole numbers. So that's really the main difference between natural number and whole numbers. Whole numbers includes 0. The next level up are our integers. On our integers, those include numbers all on the number line. So for instance, we have our number line. They, of course, include 0, 1, 2, 3, etc., etc. It keeps going. But this time, we add on all the ones to the left of the 0 on the number line. So we have your negative 1, your negative 2, negative 3, and it includes all those in that negative direction. Those are our integers. Now, rational numbers are any number that you can write in the form a over b, where a and b are integers, and b is not 0. We can't have 0 on a denominator. Natural numbers, whole numbers, and integers are all classified as rational numbers. For example, we could take the integer negative 2, and we could turn that into a rational number. Really, all that means is it can be written in a fraction, where the top and bottom numbers rational numbers. So we have negative 2 on top, and then we can put that over 1. So that can actually be written as a rational number, where the numerator and the denominator are both integers. So these are your fractions. An example also might be like 2/3 or negative 7/8 and so on and so forth. Those are our rational numbers. Now, we have one more set of numbers. The definition is not on here, but it is called irrational numbers. Your irrational numbers are going to be numbers like pi. Those are numbers that cannot be written in the form a over b, okay? These are like pi. You might even see a square root number such as square root of 7 or something like that. These are numbers that are non-terminating and non-repeating. So they don't ever end in a decimal form, and they don't repeat. There's no pattern. They're irrational numbers. Now, what I want to do for you real quick is I've given you your real number Venn diagram to fill out with these notes. Here's how we do this. This middle circle is natural numbers, okay? So like I said, these are the ones that start off with 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. So that inner circle is natural numbers. The next one up is whole numbers. So whole numbers just really include all the natural numbers, but they have in addition to it a 0. So they include all of these natural numbers plus the 0. When we come up to integers, is the next level up. Those we include whole numbers, natural numbers. So we have 0, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. And then this time, though, we also add in like that negative 1, negative 2, negative 3, and so on and so forth, all the way to negative infinity. So these are all of our integers. It includes this circle, okay? It includes this circle, which has your negative numbers like this. And then it also includes 0, which is your whole numbers, and it includes all the natural numbers. So that's why it's a Venn diagram. That's how it works. And then these up here are your rational numbers. And again, all of these, natural, whole, and integer, are going to be included in that rational number set. But in addition to all of these numbers, we can add in numbers like 2/3 and negative 1/5 and 7/8 and negative 29/30. Okay, we can include numbers like that in this rational set. Now, all of these are what we call real numbers. This is the entire real number system. In this little box way over here, we have integers. Or not integers, I'm sorry. Irrational numbers. And these are like pi and square root of 7, square root of 2. These are all numbers that are non-terminating and non-repeating. Okay, these are all of your irrational numbers. They are still included in this real number system, but they are not rational, so they are not included in this system at all. They're just separate up here, and they're not rational numbers, but they are real numbers. Okay, so now let's go back and classify some of these numbers. Looking at example one, it says classifying numbers. Name the set of numbers to which each number belongs. We have the number negative 17 over 31. Okay, now because this is in a form A over B, and both the top and the bottom are both integers, this one we call a rational number. It's not a whole number, it's not an integer, it's not none of those things. It is a rational number because it is written as in the form A over B, and both the top and the bottom are both integers. Now, letter B, if you look at that's in your natural numbers, okay? But it's also in your whole numbers, and it is also in your rational numbers. I believe I skipped one. Also your integers. So it's all of those numbers. It belongs into all four sets of those. It's because it's in this middle innermost circle. So it's, since it's in the innermost circle, it's included in all of these above it. Okay. We couldn't say a rational number is a natural number, but we can say all natural numbers are rational numbers. Now we have the number 0. The number 0, it's not a natural number, because remember, natural numbers started at 1, but it is a whole. It is an integer, and it is rational. All right, 4.581. Now, this is a decimal, and I know a lot of decimals end up being irrational numbers unless they are unless they terminate or they have a repeating pattern. So this one right here, it doesn't have a repeating pattern, however, it does terminate. So that means we can call this a rational number because the decimal stops, okay? So that is a rational number. All right, example 2 says which set of numbers is most reasonable for each situation. All right, so let's look at letter A. It says the number of students who will go on the class field trip. Okay, if we just think about this. It's probably going to be natural numbers because you can't have a fraction of a student. You can only have numbers of students. We might could consider whole numbers if no students go, but if no students go, there's not a trip anyway. So I'm thinking probably natural numbers is going to be the best way to describe that. The height of the door frame in your classroom. Now, door frames are not always going to be right on a whole number or a natural number. We're going to have fractions when it comes to the height of anything. So we would call this a rational. We would want a rational number there. Cost of a scooter. It is likely it could be an integer or a natural number or a whole number. But a lot of times things cost, maybe $39.99 or something like that. So I think this one, we probably want to go ahead and call a rational as well. Okay, next thing we're going to look at is some vocabulary. We're going to look at the word called counterexample. A counterexample is an example that proves that a statement is false. So someone might say, it is raining outside. And if you look outside and it's not raining, there's your counterexample. So we'll look at a couple of those in just a moment. An inequality is a mathematical sentence that compares the values of two expressions using an inequality symbol such as the greater than or less than. Okay, those are inequalities. And we're going to look at both of these put the both of these vocab words to use in just a moment here. Is each statement true or false? If it is false, give a counterexample. Okay, our first statement we're going to look at is all whole numbers are rational numbers. Now, you might look at your Venn diagram when thinking about this statement. All whole numbers are rational numbers. Well, if you find your whole number circle, is that whole number circle included within the rational number circle? And if you're looking at that, you will see that yes, it in fact does. So this one we would call true. The next thing we're going to look at are all whole numbers integers. If you look at this, look at that whole number circle again. Is it included within the integer circle? And here, again, you would say true because that whole number circle is included within that integer circle if you're looking at your Venn diagram. Letter C, no fractions are whole numbers. Now I want you to be careful and think about that. I know when we looked at the Venn diagram, our whole numbers, we were kind of looking at 0 and 1 and 2 and 3, and none of those seemed to be fractions. But if you remember what I said is, let's say we have the number 7. That is, in fact, a whole number. But we can make it a fraction by just simply putting it over 1, and we now have a fraction. Now, this right here is what we would call a counterexample. This statement is false. And to show that, we have the counterexample 7 over 1 because that is, in fact, a whole number. All right, now let's talk about how to order fractions. This is where we kind of talk about inequalities. Which one's smaller than, which one's the bigger one? So here we're going to talk about some inequalities. We want to put these in order from least to greatest. Now, I don't know if you remember or not, but when working with fractions, we can't not compare these fractions because they do not have the same denominator. We have an 8, we have a 2, and we have a 12. Those are not the same. So our very first step in this problem is to go ahead and get those denominators to be the same. Now, each of these denominators, we need to find out what their common denominator is. And it looks like it's probably going to go ahead and be, if we do 8, 16, 24 is probably going to be the one we have to use. So we want to get, what would we need to multiply 8 by to get that to be 24? And you find that we need to multiply it by 3. Okay, that's going to get us a new fraction of negative 9 over 24. We're going to do that same thing to the other two fractions. Let's say we have negative 1 half. To get to 24, we need to multiply that 2 by 12. And we get negative 12 over 24, okay? We have one more fraction. We have negative 5 over 12. We need to multiply this by a 2 to get to 24. So we have negative 10 over 24. Now that we have all three denominators the same, we just need to look at the numerators. Now, here we need to be careful, okay? On negative numbers, if you remember, the farther left on the number line, the smaller the number. So we need to look for that numerator that's the biggest negative number. Our biggest negative number is this negative 12 over 24 here. So that one's going to be our least one. Okay, that's going to be our least one. So I'm going to write that fraction. It was negative 1 half. So negative 1 half is the least fraction. And that is smaller than the next one. The next one we want to look at is going to be this one. So that's negative 5 over 12. So we have negative 5 over 12. And this is an inequality symbol to show that negative 1 half is, in fact, smaller than negative 5 12. Okay? And then finally, we have negative 3 eighths. That's our biggest number. It is, in fact, bigger than negative 5 12. So this is where we use our inequality symbols here. All right. I hope you've enjoyed your first lesson. Bring your notes in to class tomorrow, and if you have any questions, you need to please come with questions. If you need me to work this last example, you might go ahead and try that tonight. We might work that in class when you come in. Thank you for watching.